what brought you here today? Also for me. What brought you here?
Oh, I'm sorry. I thought.
Yeah.
I was approached by a colleague, and I have lived and worked in China and Japan. Worked with South Corporation and other initiatives, and I was always very, very interested on anything that has to do with bicultural endeavors, getting to know how people think and how they operate. Obviously, in my current business, we do business in China and in Singapore and in all Asian markets. And what I remind always my colleagues, mostly American colleagues, is we're all people, we all work together, but we may approach things a little differently. So making an effort to bridge cultures and any opportunity I have, I see it as a good opportunity for me.
Hello, Mr. Fridaska. So my question is that I know your role in HBO is involved with media and technologies. And there are so many young people nowadays, they turn out to choose television as their first choice as watching media. They are now using multimedia more frequently. So what's your strategic plan of utilizing this, the multimedia, like our tablets, our smartphones, to enlarging impact among the young people? I know you have amazing works done, filmed, but how would you use the multimedia as a tool?
So there are two things. You're absolutely right. When we, even for our own employees, when we sit back and say, how do we do training? Our first approach would be through video. There are certain issues that may not be as easy along the lines of how to make some content easily multilingual. So we can always subtitle, we can always, but that's one concern. Most of the times though, we believe that video, multimedia, the ability to separate content from delivery platform is certainly the way, it's not even future, it's now. When you make HBO content, that content can run right now in more than 40 platforms, ranging from your phone, your tablet, your TV. So it is certainly the way. Technology and the ability to develop the code and to sort of talk technically a little bit, to be able to format the video for the intended device and dynamically adjust it when you say don't have enough bandwidth, that is all there. The situation is now to be able to work with providers, cable providers, telephone providers, and others to adapt it to their devices. But that is already happening.
So what are the things that you think will make content successful throughout the multimedia platform?
Well, content has to change a lot and it has to be applicable. So that is the challenge. We have to move to something that is relative and relevant. So that's one thing. The other thing, what I think you're going to see, is that more and more people that are consumers of content will become participants. So I'll give you an example. Now, this is very, very what we call blue sky, but it is happening. So right now, when you look at gaming, you're a consumer of a game. You play a game. More and more you see features of social networking into gaming. So what you'll see, instead of you just playing, you play and others can watch you and participate in your game. So what you see therefore is you become now an actor in the context of playing a game. This is not necessarily a way of creating content, it's a way of creating a whole interaction, a whole experience. So, and more and more you see developing this notion of experiences. You see that the subtle way of producing advertising, while you're watching, I'm watching my son. My son watches TV in three devices at the same time. He watches TV, he holds his computer, and then he chats. Now, this is something that we need to embrace. And the way we'll embrace it is in a simple form, just a simple example. You watch a movie and you really like those glasses. So we need to make that easier for you to be able to find those glasses and purchase it without you having to do too much work. So these are the opportunities, and this is the thought process that technology needs to facilitate. I'm not saying that, you know, HBO will do that tomorrow. That's not what I'm saying. But I do know that there's technologies that have been developed to facilitate exactly that.
So you say that participation and interaction is pretty important. Yes. But when it comes to the advertisements, do you think the old traditional way, like billboards along the road, will still be an effective way to advertise them?
Well, it depends on whom you're trying to attract. There are obviously multiple methods. We see our growth to be by means of what we call over the top, which is a device-driven delivery of content that allows you to just see what you want to see whenever you want to see it. So this is not a medium that we view as an advertising kind of capability, not in the traditional means anyway, but there are ways to do advertisement or placement still using that medium. The other thing is that you can still see part of that being offered for free, content that is being offered for free, into some conjunction with some advertising. And we see this with the major companies, major media outlets in America, that they do that. And I'm aware of also the Chinese big media that does that, the same thing, where they combine certain free content, but obviously you're subject to advertising. I don't have an opinion on billboards. I thought it was more for mass awareness, but not for targeted advertising. So if you see down the street, not down the street, but quite a bit in Times Square, mm-hmm. We do still advertise when there is a new episode of something. We use buses, we do that. But that for us is not targeted, it's just awareness.
It's awareness.
Yes.
I mean, you can find that the bus and a big bus and still have a HBO's, you know, an advertisement.
Right.
Yeah. I just have a question. What's your favorite HBO show?
I love it.
Westworld, actually. Because I'll piss off everybody else. I love Westworld. You know, there is so many. It's funny because sometimes when I wear a hat or something that reveals that I work for HBO, people stop and said, I was watching True Detective and it didn't make any sense. but the unfair advantage is that I have access, obviously, to future episodes. So it's part of my job to actually be aware of future episodes so that I know if there is anything controversial. That's part of our business.
How many times do you spend for your watching your HBOs?
I watch all the time. I have a TV in my office. I watch all the time.
Okay.
I have to say, not only HBO, okay? So because there are other shows. You know, my daughter came the other day and she said, do you have access to Netflix? And I said, baby, we've got to talk. But, you know, you know, it's what I was telling you before. Content and delivery of content in our business is very interesting. Mm-hmm. We produce original content, so does Amazon. Yeah. So to some degree, you can say we're competitors. But yeah. HBO actually runs on Amazon the Fire Stick. So we view it as a very nice delivery mechanism. So we work very well together in this content business. And it is not anymore the old, channel-driven, cable-driven delivery. It's a whole new delivery mechanism now.
So I noticed that you used to work in Amazon, right?
Yes.
So what kind of knowledge or experience you have brought to this company?
I was doing something totally different on Amazon. I was not doing anything that had to do with video. I was working mostly on security infrastructure, and most of it was in Wall Street, mm-hmm. big, complicated deliveries of cloud architecture. So it was interesting you say that. When I was interviewing with HBO, I made a point. I'm not a media guy. I'm not media. Why are you even talking to me? Because they the migration from a traditional media to this new space requires to bring skills that are not traditional. Mm-hmm. It's not because of a style of thinking, it's because of experiences that you say you need to be able to understand how you distribute applications that are now a combination of capturing a client real time, managing credit cards, and dealing with delivery of content. Media was not doing this. They were not in that business. Very early days, if you were to ask a person at HBO, even 4 or 5 years ago, how many customers we have? Five, six, seven, that's it. Now, it's a whole different story because our customers are direct consumers. It's a big shift in our business. So that requires new skills, new talent, me excluded, that we bring in.
And also the 24 hours, and all the generations, you should be certified this kind of, you know, and market?
It's tough.
Yeah.
Right now, it is a tough problem, especially in areas like New York. Compete with obviously a lot of companies. We do find people that are they love to work with HBO because they love the show.
And
that is good. It helps to our advantage. But at the same time, you do compete with a lot of companies. We do have a nice way to. I have found that by bringing interns, using the internship program, and developing young people, it is a good mechanism to bring. They're also very excited to learn and to apply their knowledge. And we've actually, interesting, we have built quite an opinion about different schools and their programs, because we see them firsthand. We do see how different schools become more. They teach more people around policy, more about technology, in depth, more hands-on. So we get to know now. I've been doing this at HBO, the internship program, for a good 2 years now. So we get to know how they react and what kind of people they develop.
Yeah. Just as you just mentioned, Amazon is kind of the competitor to HBO. And this year, Amazon will probably spend twice as much on television as HBO. Mm-hmm. So how does HBO try to deal with those kind of competitors?
We don't necessarily view it that way, and it's not for me as a technologist to deal with that. But mostly, we try to tell a story the best way we can, and we try to bring that the movies, the series, all of that to as many platforms as possible. So it is not about whether in a certain season you're going to spend more money on this, more money on that. Right now, we're trying to develop the best technology there is out there. And as I said, I was saying before, I guess I threw a number out there, 30-some platforms. You try to see, can you get into more platforms? Can you reach more people? That is really what matters. Mm-hmm. It's not a matter of pure comparison of numbers.
Mm-hmm. In terms of delivering the content, Amazon Prime members can get certain access to HBO shows right now, right?
Yes.
Does this kind of fragmentation where users can get content outside of HBO could dilute the brand?
No, I don't think so. Because you give someone the opportunity to get to know you. And if that is by way of, say, taking advantage of a Prime membership, that's fine. Or in any other way, we offer to students, we have certain offers. We have, even if we recently offered a card-based transaction for people that don't have credit cards. Mm-hmm. So we're trying to reach out to as many as possible. Mm-hmm. And then if that is, is the same content at the end of the day, that we're not trying to segment in any way to say that you're not going to view this or somebody else. You do get certain advantages if you become an HBO Now client. Certain times you may get the episode before others by a day or so, but that's as far as it goes. All content will be available to everybody.
So do you think contents made HBO successful, or HBO make those contents more famous?
Well, content and storytelling, the way we, what we have is what makes us, I believe, unique. A lot of, at the end of the day, even if you see how companies, I should say, evolve, they'll have the ability to play content on a computer or on a phone. They will, and or they do already. What makes us different is that we actually have what we call the certain HBO quality, that what comes out, it will actually be well done, it will be exciting. There are certain things that I came to know being at HBO. I was trying to say to myself, what is that is so different? If you actually see, a story actually never ends. If you look at a lot of the shows, and this is my own opinion, this is not by design, it just happens to be, the story, there's always something hanging out, and you say, there's no closure ever. That's the HBO way, that there is not, everybody died and we moved on. No. Even if you see, you know, my favorite show, we threw something there. There was this samurai. So say, what's going to happen in the next season? There's always this hanging. And some people hate that, actually, because there's no closure. But your question is the quality of what's going to, because we believe at the end of the day, this is what's going to make us different. Keep on doing well what you do, and the consumer will tell the difference. We'll be able to see something that was actually has the HBO quality to it.
So my last question is that, sorry, so since many of us sitting here are all fans of HBO's episodes, and the Game of Thrones is coming back.
Yes.
Really soon, and we are all excited. So since you're here, do you
July
mind?
July 16th, yes.
Yeah, so do you mind telling us a little bit about what's gonna happen in the new? Like, who's gonna die this time?
Okay, I tell you what, I'll tell you something. I'm not gonna tell you who's gonna die. As a matter of fact, I don't actually know that. But I will tell you something very interesting that you may find entertaining. You know that Game of Thrones is shot in two locations, one in Belfast and another one in Spain. From a security perspective, one of the problems we had is drones flying over taking pictures.
Right.
The problem we had with that is that the dragons that you see are actually drones also. So it is very difficult to deal with that, and it is becoming a problem. Drones are becoming problematic as much as they became, they gave us a new avenue of actually filming. But we did have a lot of issues, and the current legislature is that they are aircrafts. So you can shoot them, you can throw nets at them. We had all kinds of people telling us all kinds of ways. We cannot deal with that. We have to do it a proper way. So here's something unique, an inside story, that you know, we had to deal with that problem, especially for the Games of Thrones, because it is a very big set, and people did do that.
You kind of have already answered my question at the beginning of the conversation, like what would be the future of the traditional media?
The future would be much more interactive. There's going to be that. There's going to be the ability to see, to do what we call multi-device viewing. So you have different experience. The other thing, as much as we believe that is not there yet, the bigger formats, the high definition, and the 4K, that will give us the ability to actually see better. It will be a much more vivid experience. Then the other thing we didn't talk about at all is virtual reality. So what we see happening is that you'll be able to go to be part of a show without actually being part of a show physically, without going to the studio. So this is a great opportunity for us. But I do believe, technically speaking, the technical challenges are immense. The amount of bandwidth that's going to take is very, very significant. So many a time I say, because we have experimented with different ways to see, and I have been a consumer of it. I have seen certain very, very early depictions of shows on the VR. It's going to be great. But I'm also saying we're years away from mass delivery of content that way. And I hope that the investment is there and the opportunity is there, and a lot of that will come from you guys to actually speed it up. But that's the future. It's going to be very exciting.
Yeah, I'm the last, not the least. I have two questions, very short.
Yes.
I just appreciate that your performance, the long history, HBO is very famous in the States and all over the world now. And you stay in the Chinese money and invest in your programs?
I have no idea.
you have not the capital ventures from the Chinese, you know, and the investment?
Oh, I'm pretty sure, and I'm aware of even our Warner Brothers division opening an office in China. But and I do know that we do have sales and we do have integration with Chinese outlets.
Okay.
So I hope it's more.
Yeah, that's why, you know, as I know that some of the Chinese, you know, investment in the culture development with the Hollywood. They must be increased a lot, you know, and investment for their venture capitals. But this is why I was very interested that we and your HBO and where we combine this kind of, you know, the parish, a lot of, you know, and investors from always from China. So that's my first question. So you have already moved and talked to me. And the second, facing the very, very and competitive advantages of the technologies and from different, you know, and in the medias, in the, you know, and the and, feature story and whatever. So that's where, how you facing this kind of competitions? For instance, Verizon is involved, this kind of, you know, and feature. And APP is not popular. I was introduced by the APP from the, you know, other peoples. Go 90s, that's a face of the young generation. And that's where we are very easily access to the people. Mm-hmm. And how you are facing this kind of, you know, and the taste of the young generation. And the, another way, and now it's very easily and for the globally and be delivered all the, you know, and the films and very quickly. Mm-hmm. So for instance, in China, we had the best TV. This APP is very, very and populous nowadays in China. You can easily access to watching the old feature story. How are you facing this kind of, you know, competitions?
So there are two thoughts as you speak that came to my mind.
Okay.
There is the thought of we want. There's one thing to want the consumer to to subscribe to HBO, but that's only at the tail end. What you want is the artist. You want the developer to work with HBO. And that is really the big deal. It is my job as a technologist to make sure they get whatever they want, to make it really, to make them excited. As much as our business leaders and our executives attract talent, but it is my job to make sure that when they sign up to work with HBO, they feel that they have no constraint, that it is an environment that it is really open to them to have artistic expression and happiness.
Okay.
That's now interesting about China. As we look at rolling out into new platforms, even technology, we realize that it is it's a culture of very attached to the cell phone.
Yeah.
It's a culture of multiple devices.
Yes.
So we are very much aware of that, and we're making a point to even look at how it will work on a Chinese phone, how will even phones that you cannot get in the US. So I'm telling you, we have made an effort to put our hands into phones that you cannot buy here, working with our affiliates in out of our Chinese offices. We have in Shanghai and in Beijing.
Yeah,
and
the Firos.
Yes, and we tell them, send us these phones, let's see how it works on that. We do make a point to, we're not as much, you know, we're aware of what the consumer in your areas uses and try to make it as possible,
as possible,
good experience.
As much as possible.
Yes. Well, a lot of that is affected by the bandwidth that you have, yeah. And it's affected by how old your phone is, and all these parameters that you have to.
Yeah.
But our technology can easily adapt. And
all the and the how many years and you can adopt it. Now it's you know renew of the telephone is so fast.
Yes. But people still find themselves in a situation where when you watch a movie, you have to have the ability technically to drop the quality from, say, high definition to even standard definition to play to a phone that happens to be in a location that is not as accessible. So we do all that, and we try to be as open as possible and aware of what you guys use every day.
Yeah, thank you very much.
My pleasure. I hope this was
I just
useful.
Have a question.
Yes, please.
ITOT just acquired Time Warner last year, and a lot of people say it will change the landscape of American entertainment industry. So I want to ask about what's like HBO's change of strategy business, and what's your idea about that?
Well, first of all, the it has not acquired.
Yeah.
This is a process.
Okay.
That is.
Yeah.
Is now underway.
Yeah,
it has not been finalized. So, and that's as much as I know. This is not a process that it is still being evaluated by various agencies and so on. For us, it's, at my level, is as business as usual. It's obviously, as an employee, there is a lot of opportunity for us. And to some degree, as you can imagine, uncertainty, but we see most a tremendous opportunity to see what's going on. But for a day-to-day basis, I can tell you, we have a busy schedule this year. We have a lot of exciting shows coming up, and we're heads down just dealing with those and continue to do what we do well.
So it's so welcomed by the everyone. So would you mind have a picture taken today?
Yeah.
Would you mind?
Let me. 很多人都说这个北美的电影市场其实比较低迷，就是没有中国的 entertainment industry 这么的，就是那么 high 的 profit。然后，但是万达还是坚持收购 AMC。我就想问问您，在收购之后的这段时间，您觉得这样一个发展是不是在您的期待中，或者有什么惊喜？
对这个问题其实问得特别好，因为我可能是这个世界上对这个问题最有发言权的几个人之一，因为我之前在 AMC 上班上了三年。我是作为万达收购 MC 之后派的 MC 的股东代表，唯一的股东代表。这个问题呢，在我们当时收购的时候，其实就做过很多调查。美国市场或者北美电影市场呢，是个非常成熟的市场，每一年的增幅，或者说在近三十年呢，其实它这个观影人数和票房收入呢是非常稳定的，一年的增幅一般不会超过3%，甚至有时候是下降。所以说呢，我们收购这个 AMC 呢，考虑的呢，并不是说从这个纯粹的是为了这个收购中得到利润。其实我们主要是一个战略并购，也就是说，万达在中国有万达院线，但是呢，万达院线已经是中国第一、亚洲第一了。你如果要做到世界第一的话，你不可能把万达院线去美国、去欧洲再去开新的电影院。如果达到世界第一，那就只能通过并购。并购的话，AMC 当时是我们一个比较好的选择，因为 AMC 当时是个 private company， 还不是 public company。如果收购一个 public company 的话，会非常复杂，在法律上啊，在那个诉讼方面都会很麻烦，所以我们当时选择了 AMC。这个收购以后呢，当年实现了盈利，这个也是不能说是没有预测的，但是确实也是有点让我们喜出望外。这个主要是因为我们对于它这个收购后的 MC 呢进行一个改革。这个改革简单的讲呢，就是说，我们对它注入了更多的现金。MC 呢历史上呢都是由一些那个 hedge fund 的、mutual fund 的去控制的，他们呢对这个公司就是说买进来卖出去，他没有对这个它这个真正的业务的支持。而我们收购，我们当时是7亿美金的现金。 收购的股权，然后当年在两个月之内我们又投了1亿美金去做他那个院线的更新改造，这个在他们历史上可能从来没拿到过这么的现金，用于他的经营，都是在股东之间倒来倒去。所以这样的话就是说有现金做这个新的这个业务增长点了，这是造成他这个收入和利润增加的一个原因。另外一个呢，由于万达的并购，因为万达本身在世界上或者说在很多银行界呢是有很高的这个信用评分，所以说通过这个收购呢，它就算是万达的一个子公司，这样的话它在融资的时候会拿到很低的 rate。 当年在收购时 MC 有20亿美金的那个 bond 还有那种 credit line，你想想当时它的平均利率大概是9%，而我们收购以后它的利率降到6%，一年减少3%，你看能带来多少利润。所以说这个从多方面入手吧，还有管理层的一些激励，这是一个我们收购以后呢就是说同意把净利润的10%分给管理层的一个高管，大概30多个人，这个的话对他们来说也是一个非常强大的一个激励措施，因为这个金额非常大。你想想看，第一年2012年我们的利润是5000多万美金，我们拿出了500多万分给20个人，平均一个人能拿多少钱，是吧？然后第二年2013年我们拿出了1亿美金的10%，1000万分给这30多个人，这样的话对他们那个管理层是一个很大的一个正向的引导作用。所以说这个现在这个比较形势比较好的状况不是白来的，也确实是我们经过很多努力才达到的这个局面。
嗯，
我就想问一下，那针对现在这么一个盈利的局面呢，那现在万达对未来就是对 AMC 这一边有怎样的期待和计划？
这个问题其实 AMC 现在呢，他又收购了第4大的那个卡麦克电影公司，然后收购了欧洲的一大院线，所以说 AMC 现在已经成为世界上最大的电影院线，而且占了整个世界电影市场大概10%的份额。这种情况下，我不能代表万达说什么对未来预测，但是我个人认为啊，就是你们记住是说，反正是我个人意见，我认为这个 AMC 的呢，可能是走向一个organic growth 的一个趋势吧，因为它法律上可能也不太允许它做更多的并购，它已经成了第一大，它会有一些那个 antitrust 的那个规定，它不能收购太多的电影院了。所以说，我认为它是一个从那个经管理那个去挖这个收入来源的一个阶段，我认为会进入。
就是现在有很多中国的电影都渴望就是进入北美市场，然后要在发行啊宣发当中，但其实有的时候效果并不是那么理想，一方面可能是因为咱们就是文化中间有差异。那你觉得就是就是万达收购了 AMC 这样的一个行为会对中国电影在北美市场的发展或者对在未来的走向世界走向上有什么样的作用吗？
其实我并不太适合回答这些问题啊，因为我现在已经不在 MC 了，而且我应该是从2年前就从 MC 调到了现在这个房地产这个项目上。这个问题你们可以问，最好不要发表，就是说中国的电影呢，这2年大家可以看到一些可喜可贺的一些变化。
公司在这边投资，就是包括并购这些，不管是电影公司还是说房地产这个方面，从您的角度有什么样的建议或者想法？
还是那句话，这些问题可能你们最好别发表，因为我不适合于回答这个问题。我们公司是上市公司，这种对外发表的话，我是不能说这种话，尤其是对未来的预期。我们在预期呢，5-6年之内呢，应该会在美国再投7-8个这种项目。这个房地产项目呢，我们主要是为了引进万达酒店的品牌，也就是说每个房地产项目呢，我们都会放一个万达酒店在里头，这是我们的主要目的。我们希望在美国的一些主要的这种 gateway city 里头都能放一个万达酒店在里头。纽约的项目我们从2012年就一直在看，但是现在目前还没有发现特别合适的项目而已。
因为之前有投资公司投资纽约这边的一些酒店，但是是因为文化的原因或者因为政策不太了解，然后频频受阻。请问您对这个问题有没有就是先前的考虑，或者是打算未来打算怎么解决？
所以我们走的是不同的路线，我们是自己去建酒店，用自己的品牌去管理的酒店，所以这就应该不太会存在这种文化差异的问题了。我们自己的，我们是业主也是管理者，这个跟安邦和那个有些海航买的酒店不一样，他们只是一个财务投资者，他们成为了业主，但是让酒店经营本身他们并不参与管理。
谢谢。
曾经想过收购希尔顿酒店，大概在4年前吧，但是因为价格没谈拢，所以说这个也是在这种形势下呢，我们趋向于用自己的品牌去管理酒店，不要因为万达酒店在美国没有现成的酒店，或者说还比较少，就认为它不适应美国的市场，或者说不适应国际市场。实际上，万达酒店在万达体系里头是国际化最快的最大的一个产业吧。我们在国内的万达酒店的总经理，各个万达酒店的总经理基本上都是外国人，印度人、美国人、欧洲人，所以说呢，在美国搞的酒店对我们来说根本都不存在所谓这个文化差异的问题，因为现在已经有好几个美国人，当时万达公司的美国雇员哈，跟我联系说，哎，你们那个酒店开了，我要回来了，我是美国人，我要到芝加哥来管我们的酒店。所以说这个我酒店方面我是非常有信心的，不会有一些什么市场障碍。
那万达集团的资产配置基本上都在影视业，
从一开始地产发展到后来您说的文化，那你觉得一个成功的一个企业，不论是大小的，还是一个有成熟的，还是个新兴的，你觉得一个成功的一个企业文化应该会是什么样的？
一个成功的企业必然它会有一个成功的企业文化，万达的企业文化呢，它是有万达特点，也就是说它适应这个最近这20多年中国经济的一个变革，然后总结出这么一个现有的这么一个文化，就是说，时间节点比较要求比较高，还有那个对人的重视程度非常高，因为我们公司是个重资产的一个公司嘛，所以说在管理上一定非常严格，一旦有损失的话金额都非常大，所以说我们是这么一个企业文化。但这个企业文化并不，我不认为它会适用放之四海皆准理哈，就是说如果把这种文化放到嫁接到一个服务行业，他们说一个餐馆，是不是有必要这个时间节点卡这么严呢？那可能更重要的是质量或者是服务态度，但这个在万达这种服务态度和这个质量当然很重视，但这种可能不是服务态度什么的就不是第一位考虑的东西。所以说这个文化各有各的特点吧，那个所有的公司他会自己总结出自己适合的文化出来。
好，谢谢。
上周五的那个
现在创博对这个税制的一些改革，包括那个医疗保险的一些改革呢，我认为它是一个短期的现象吧，也就是说可能会对一两年的这个企业发展和经营环境有很大的变化，但是呢从长期看呢，整个美国建国20多年它那个还是非常稳定的这个外部经营环境，所以说我认为从长期来看，我们原来干什么的话现在也不会太多受到这个Trump上台后的影响。当时就说我们董事长王健林先生也都在川普上台以后也说发表了很多正面的一些那个评价，所以说大家如果有兴趣可以去找他的发言，这样子是最准确的。
理解做 due diligence 这种方式方法是在跟学的当中逐渐带到工作当中去 practice 才有效的。
对，我觉得你这个讲得很好，就是说我们中国很多时候就是就希望着那个能不能你教我，我马上就成为 Bill Gates， 马上就成为马云啊，这样子有什么绝招，这样子就是特别的，就好像就想吃最后一块面包的感觉。 对吧？前面都不管了，就是你把这个我怎么样，成为这个百万富翁，这样就我们看，有些人到中国去演讲也说，我怎么样成为一个诺贝尔奖获得者，是吧？这都是很单纯的事。但是实际上是教育来讲的，很多的时候，它其实是教育你是一种怎么做人，怎么做事，怎么样去思考一些事情。所以很多时候就说，你经常看到有人说，哦，我学这么东西啊，80%都是没有用的。但是好多这百分之八没什么用的，它是跟你人已经在一起，就它成为人的一部分。所以教育的时候，不仅就是说像做咨询一样的，我就马上给你解决问题，它更多的是教你一种思维方式，怎么去做人。我觉得这个来看的话，其实很多时候还是我们要相当于是看事情看更长远一点，就是。
啊，我觉得我非常认同前两位的说法。这个首先吧，我不是念商学院的，所以我是念的数学，所以这个可能对商学院的这个学什么发言权比较少，但是因为跟很多同事都是商学院过来的，包括我招的那些同事都是商学院过来的，所以呢我认为真正的那种所谓 hard skill 其实在学校里学到的并不多，有很多比如说你学很多经济理论啊、发言式理论啊什么，这个东西真的至少在投资界，你们这个东西太烂了，这个东西也没有用，哇，这是 real world， 来，就是要你解决这个问题，我就是没有好数据，你就是要把这个数据给自己给它整理出来，然后这些是知道这些数据，知其不可为而为之，这个就是说要有一个人要有一个聪明的一个，所以第一人要像，人要像，人要像，这个是最最重要的。这个，
我刚才讲他是这个最近讲的很好，就说其实就一个人还要像非常 adaptive， 就是你很多时候你需要东西，你要 adapt to the your kind of current situation 这很重要。还有一个我想讲的就是说这个在这个跟这个 hard science 不太一样的地方，在这个做这个金融啊或者做商业里面，就是他的 communication skill 也非常重要，就是说这个。你能够把你的这个 idea 你 effectively communicate to others， 而且呢有的时候还有 very timely， 就是说比如说你跟人家 argue 的时候，或者就是有的时候在这个公司里面有些 parties 的时候，你要在这个 right time 就是把事情讲出来 effectively communicate， 不然就说有些事情我就是说觉得怎么搞的，该我的这个 contribution 我的这个我这个苦劳有功劳没有，然后也不敢说出来，所以回家去生闷气，对吧？那就说明有点其实就不能够把你的这个 strength 和你的这个 contribution effectively communicate 出来的话，其实也不行。一方面你要能够就是说把事情做出来，把 get things done， 然后 communicate your contribution to others， 而且另外一个你还能够就 fight for your kind of you know rights and your positions， 这也非常重要。我觉得这一点在中国就是说它在这个 communication 方面的话，可能放的这个东西不太重要。就为什么我们经常讲，就是说你看在这个美国这个第一代移民里面，其实我们都觉得说我们中国这个华人都很优秀，但其实做得更好的可能是印度人，他们第一代移民可以做到这个像这个City 的 CEO， 对吧？像做到这个像 Pepsi 做到这个 Google Microsoft 这些中华民族很少，就我们还需要很多的反思，也就是说我们很多人觉得自己也不比人家笨，但是呢就是说好像干的事情还挺多的，但是呢一开会的时候什么都讲不出来啊，然后就是有的人做的事情不多，但是他讲的偷偷知道，是吧？还有什么东西大包大揽全拿下来再说，最后干苦活的都是中国人，这个我觉得还需要加强这个 communication skill 另外一个我觉得还有一个 big picture， 有的时候一个新人做一个他就一下子转到里面就不出来了，就是说我看了在这个公司里面到底处于什么样的位置，那个什么样就是说能够在这个更上一层楼，这方面我觉得中国有的时候可能也比较胆怯，就是我也许我们这一代人这个语言还不够哈，尽管就是说店里面说你语言不好，我觉得你语言相当比我要好多了。对，但这块我觉得就是说，我觉得中国人还是有点这个怯场，就是说让你出去讲话的时候，可能就是吭哧也说不出我们的话出来。我觉得这块我估计我们还是要好好想一想。这其实不仅在这个第一代移民，包括在第二代移民里面，你发现 A B C 里面，就是说和这个印度的这 A B C 第二不是 A B C 还不是 A B C 了，这 A B I 是吧？他们的话好像也有距离。这块我觉得我们还在美国对吧，我们都有小孩啊什么这个，还要好好反思一下，就是说怎么样能够就是说我们那个摆脱这种比较这种东亚人比较听命的这种感觉，就是说我们也可以说一些穿帮带啊，然后 我觉得这个现在这个会有些做得很好，也就是我们可以怎么样，就是说从这个老中青三集合，对吧？我们把这个前面带来的这种不管是成功的失败经验，如何下面一代能够多多交流。
因为今年正好也差不多是距离刚才那个同学说的Big Shot 这个 financial recession 也差不多十年了，所以我就想问一下各位，这十年来其实我们都看到大银行就不断的在裁员，可能有经济迟迟没能回暖的原因，但更多也许有系统性的刚才你们在讨论的各种技术如何改变金融业的原因。所以我想问问你们在十年内看到的过去最大的变化是什么，然后我们能预见到在未来五到十年能看到一个短期的未来的变化又是什么。
那你现在把你经历过这个
这个危险最明显的一个就是刚才提到的这个 regulation， 对，这个是从这个监管层面来说呢，就是特别在美国和欧洲这两个地域啊，就是 regulation 已经到了一种非常疯狂的地步，就是大家如果在大银行里就知道，现在银行里招的最多的人就是 compliance 和 risk management， right？ 为什么也不是银行为什么要招？因为他就需要你做很多很多报表，他这个报表做到就是很，就是说有的你就知道这个东西其实是非常一个。有的东西它其实你要去真的要去把它做成一个非常非常，因为你知道金融里面有很多很多稀奇古怪的东西，这个东西每个东西的 risk 是不一样的，但是你如果上面从自上而下的有一个框架说你必须要 report 这个，那么这个东西呢和这个本身你要有的这个东西啊就是很不一样。你要如果去一个硬要把一个圆的东西套到一个方的东西里面的话，你就可能产生无非就是把那个圆的东西削方了，或者把那个洞给开大了，或者怎么样，就是说就是这样。因为你上面的这个 Dodd-Frank 他一帮子人就是想了说你必须要怎么样怎么样这个一套东西，然后你要把整个世界的里面好多东西要去套进去，你套进去你套不进的话无非两个，一个这个 business 不能做了，还有一个就是说我就糊弄就给你乱写一个东西，因为这个东西你没有那个这个就具体的事情其实是很那个就非常，所以呢这个就是一个理念，美国的这个现在的监管的一个理念就是什么，就是说是上面的人想出来的东西是最聪明的，这个就是一个很糟糕的一个理念，这个就和我们过去中国的这个计划经济时代一样，就是说上面的人想的东西是最聪明的，下面的人只要跟着上面去做就好了，这是一个很糟糕的一个现象。所以说这个 regulation 并不是不能完全不要，但是就是说你如果用到了就是害到你这个具体的这个做事情的话，这个就必须要反思一下。对，这个这是一个变化。第二个变化呢就是monetary policy。所以我们知道这个一有这个经济recession 以后欧洲也好这个美国也好甚至中国也好想到的办法就是用钱，对吧？所以就是说大家的就是框叫他怎么怎么怎么QE 也好啊，叫他什么也好，无非就是印钱。印钱了以后，就是产生一个现象，就是所有的资产都很贵。Okay？ 一个有些东西他认为你不能做的，就不好可以做。这个比如说什么呢？比如说我们做的那个 MBS， 这个 non-agency RMBS 就没有了。现在就没有了，因为它不可以做。这个就是说，这个它 regulation 一来啊，什么东西一来啊，这个怎么这个risk reserve 的这个东西给你算的无穷贵，所以这个银行就不能持有了。所以这些东西就后来就越做越少，越做越少，这个没有了。但是呢，其他剩下来的东西呢都巨贵。你看 stock 这个也非常非常的贵。
这个 bond 的 yield 很厉害，所以呢，所以这样的东西一来呢，就是说，就造成了一个泡，人为的造成，就是你说这个不是泡沫，这是它造出的一个泡沫。所以中国也是这个样子，其实也有这样的一个情况，就是印通过印钱以后就变成了，变成了就是说，当然如果说这个做 finance 的人赚很多钱，然后这个 main street 的人都赚很少钱，这个是个不正常现象，这个不能不可持续的。这个很快的这个国家的经济就会空心化。OK， 这个所以呢，这个是对的，就是说不能让华尔街的人赚了太多钱。这个啊，但是你这个想的办法，这个要不能够用这个，不要用想一个好一点的办法 ，right？ 这个啊，所以这个事情怎么样，最后怎么样的调整？这个当然，这个要从非常宏观的来讲。当华尔街的人这个每年这个债，像 Paulson 一年债四个 billion 也不对，这个啊。
对，我可能说几句，我觉得那个宇俊跟 Henry 讲的非常好，我讲比较简单一些，就整的来看那个 financial industry， 刚你提这个问题，20年前吧，是挺赚钱的，有很多的 innovation 在这个 modeling products， 现在的话基本上是一个 mature industry， 跟那个 technology 啊那种 Google 了，就根本没有办法比，所以说从整个 industry 的 profitability 角度来讲的话，过去在今后的5年10年不会有很多的，就是说我不觉得会有很多的就是这个 upside， 但是从比方说这个 ecosystem， 因为它在 evolving， 刚刚我们谈的很多的就是 innovation， 这个创新在这个 ecosystem 当中，就是说不同的player 它有不同的它的自己的创新在能够带给这个整个 ecosystem 的一些新的能力吧，就是说刚刚谈到的一些 fintech，然后有一些能源啊或者是资源的需求也是从这方面出来的，如果说从就业的角度来说的话，你像我的话还是要招挺多人的，从不光是 compliance 还有就是那种 risk management 的这些 talent， 很多的时候还是要看那种multi-talented 的那个就是 individual， 就是说比方说我这个 field 吧，我看是那个全球的网络的联系，它有120多个国家，然后不同的关系，就人跟人之间的交流，这种关系的这种 skill set 是就是 artificial intelligence 或者是其他的 technology 还是非常难被代替的，所以说这方面的人才是非常需求的。他就是像 data scientist 做那些能够从 number 当中能够找到一些创新然后新的机会的话，这也是非常难得。然后从financial industry 的话，我们不善于啊去找这些人成为我们的团队，所以现在也是在从这方面找更多的创新，不同的那种企业或银行业或者是 asset manager 在一看不同的方面，像我们的话可能就是有一些innovation lab 或者是有一些 innovation investment， 我们自己的话也会就是说出很多的投资是 internal organization 当中找到这些创新，或者是就是跟其他的一些startup 有这方面的联系才把它逐渐壮大起来，这可能就是对我们来说今后5年10年要怎么样能够跟上这个整个大的经济的发展规划这样子。
我就简短的加两句吧，一个的话我觉得这个现在我们社会上钱很多，热钱跟2006-2007年那时候差不多，a lot of money, a lot， 而且这个 money is concentrated in the hands of a small percentage of the population，所以这是一个现象吧，这个好像也是没有变化。第二个的话呢，我觉得现在刚才非常同意他们讲的，现在正在在这个变革中间，就是这个2008年 financial crisis 产生的这个效果，现在其实还没有完全这个 get out。I think the society, the systems are still going through transformation。
我想接着问一个关于 fintech 的问题，因为知道曹老师对 fintech 很有研究 ，City 在过去这几年也花了很多精力来研发 fintech。那因为很多的就是说 fintech startup 在美国，它是由于这个regulation 的限制是没有银行牌照的。那这些传统金融行有没有考虑跟 startup 合作呢？
有，我们有挺多的，就是说从不同的，刚刚你在 panel 上也谈到一些比较初级的，因为从一开始的毛络的话，刚刚 fintech 起步的时候，我们其实把他们看作有一些是竞争关系的，因为我们在做的他们也可以在做，但是逐渐在这个他们在 develop 他们那个 product 的过程当中，他 realize 他没有 license， 他没有办法做，所以这个关系都在 evolve。所以我们之后很多的就是跟 FinTech 成为 partner， 有很多的 partnership， 然后在不同的这个 processing 这个 line 当中，有很多都是非常 creative 的。你像这种大的，你像 PayPal 啊，这种Apple Pay 啊， Samsung Pay 啊，它需要有一些banking license 在 backend 帮它能够做起来，然后它那个 scale 可能有一些小的 startup FinTech 的话，它没有这个 scale， 它那个 transaction 要 process through。就是完全就需要有大的银行这样一个 partnership， 然后另外一个很重要的一点就是它的客户的 access， 它因为它刚刚起步的话，它没有这个客户的资源，它尽管这个 model 非常好，它希望能够把这个 business model concept 这个 product 能够带到很大型的客户企业当中去，它很多时候就是在如果跟大的银行能够建立合作关系的话，它这个发展速度会非常快。然后从我们银行的角度来说的话，因为如果我们自己内生自己就是投资发展的话，可能这个速度就跟不上，就是这就这个 partnership 的这个优势就会体现出来。
对这块，我觉得中国可能说不定将来做的会比美国还要大，就是你知道蚂蚁金服可能今年就要上市了，我们有个同事叫春荣啊，他也是我在2010年的时候把他招到长江来，但是他现在是2014年他就去了这个蚂蚁金服做他的这个chief strategy officer。所以我觉得我参加出来第二个 business 吧，我觉得前面一个是证明他是在这个阿里巴巴做的一个企业的 strategy officer 这样子啊，所以我觉得这块的话就是为什么，因为美国银行也很成熟了，对吧？他其实你看讲的开始的时候是比较排斥这个 fintech， 而且就是说这方面美国一些包括银行里面他一些像 payment system 其实做的并不还不如中国好，对吧？你从一个银行转另外一个银行，对吧？你往 money 过去可以候的11天，对不对？那中国的网站就可以用了。非常的方便啊，所以我觉得这块的话，其实中国有很多这个潜力，而且如果看到 fintech 的它这个 top 15的 company 估值的话，中国的这个 fintech 的这个估值可能是美国的这个 top 15 fintech 的估值10倍啊，这里面可能中国的泡沫比较大，可能在前面地方去。另外一个就是说，可能中国市场也很大，而且就是中国就是它这个民间的这种银行业发展比较慢，都是靠这个国有银行，然后官方服务也不行。
我是做 personal subprime 的 personal loan 的 portfolio， 但是我觉得就是 fintech 也是我们的对手。但是我想问一下，就是说上一年 Lending Club 从10多块跌到3块多的时候，就是因为出现了那个 ABS 就是法律 regulation 的问题嘛。其实我觉得 fintech 在美国的融资方式非常的单一，它的那个 ABS 它只能通过，就是 fintech 因为没有银行的 license， 它只能通过发 ABS 到华尔街里面，就是有买主买它的 ABS 然后投资它的 ABS， 它也不像 MBS 那样有 Freddie Mae 和 Freddie Mae 那么大的市场在里面，这我觉得这个是非常大的 limitation。 那你觉得在 fintech 这个 challenge 里面如何克服这个融资的问题？这就是说一定要依靠一个大银行吗？因为 fintech 的口号就是说 I want to be independent of the big banks because they can lower their costs， 因为你 P2P 的话你本来那个利率的那个就很低，因为我们的 FICO score 是600到650左右，非常的低。然后他们那些穷的人在我们贷款，我们会收很高的那个利率，36%。但是 fintech 就可以提高一些更低的，因为它没有手续费嘛，没有 origination fees， 然后他就会那个他就真的会为很多人带来更多的便利，至于穷者更穷。所以我不知道你是怎么看这个问题的，对于 ABS 的融资问题。
你们
也
谈一谈你这个专家，
你
这个 MBS
啊，这个东西说融资问题啊，在美国，它就是像你说的，它的除了就是说过去有网上就是说直接你可以去投，就是说你作为一个投资人，
对
individual 你可以去投，哎，但是呢，这个但是不能做的很大规模，因为这个规模做的不大。要做的大规模，就是 idea 就是这样。如果我做用 ABS 来做， VNA 是来做的，这个现在市场它 flow 了这么多 money 在这个 bond market 上，所以用这个 bond market 来做这个东西。所以但是呢，这个就造成你说的，就是说它的比较单一，不像这个
我
对，就是比较单一。但这个又是一个 regulation 的问题，因为这个 regulation 呢，在美国的这个做这个东西很，它有些 disclosure 的一些 disclosure 的东西啊什么的规定就比较严，所以呢，就是说你要 meet 的这个 target 的比较多。这个东西到底是个好事还是坏事？
不知道，就是
这个不知道，因为这个国内也有，就是 P2P 后来好像也出了一点事情，就是说也有出事情的，就是说这个东西就是说真的是啊，真的是你如果一点也不管的话，你就可能就是有人就是做就做了破遍了，就是这个，所以
你们投资 ABS， 我不知道你们是不是做 trade ABS， 你们会看那个，就是说我们那些 institutional investor 会看，假如你在十二月的default rate 会过那个百分之多少的话，那你就会 bust。其实现在很多的 small 的那种 fintech go bust， 其实就是因为他没有 meet 到那个 institutional 的那个 ABS 的要求，我不知道是不是这样子。
因为是。肯定的，你如果说你要卖给我们的话，我们肯定要看你一些传统的一些就 history 啊什么，
就是 portfolio
啊，他是他们没有这个 history，
嗯，
没有这个 history 的话，你就很多很多的 institutional investor 就不能够买，
嗯，
这个再说你即使就这个包括 broker dealer 他也没办法去到 retail 上去买，
嗯，
这到 retail 上去卖，这个就是一个问题，就是说。要福建他们的那个，这 Ready Agency 也是，他也需要这个。
沈总，我还有一个问题。